Calamar.
Yeah.
So the problem with today is that it's snowing quite heavily in Calamar and snowing in Växjö, so we're quite glad that we didn't have to like catch a train today.
Yeah.
And this is quite a new thing for us, just trying to have a lecture like this in front of the camera instead of in front of the class, and we'll see how it goes. I have no idea. It's a lot of technology that we got in place like 2 minutes ago, so hopefully this will work.
Yeah.
Could you please acknowledge in the chat on Slack or on live coding, whatever, just that you can hear what I'm saying, because it would be a shame if I sat there and no one listened, or it didn't work at all. So we probably have a lag of a few seconds, but...
Yeah.
Oh, no one is right. Could be positive, though.
I think we have some lag in the live coding.
Yeah. So, yeah, whatever. We will just hope that everything works. We're recording anyways, so hopefully it will work. So this is kind of a model we will try out for the rest of the course. Instead of going to Växjö, we will try this.
Mm-hmm.
You have all met Jon, right? Yeah, on the course introduction.
Yeah. I was in Växjö when we do the introductions.
Yeah. So this lecture will be kind of, I will touch upon some of the topics of the lecture, and we might have a discussion. John, who is the expert in this field, will try to correct me if I'm wrong, and I probably have some questions to John as well, so he will be interviewed.
No, kind of.
But we will try it out, and hopefully I can do some real-time mixing with the cameras as well, so we can see. Today is talking about web servers.
Yeah.
We touched upon web servers in the last lecture,
yeah.
Or at least platform, node platform, but we will go into that from, or not that, but we will touch upon web servers today. An important topic is HTTP.
Yeah.
Especially in this course, you all touched upon HTTP in the last course when you wrote client-side applications. The sound disappeared. Now it's back.
Okay. Well, it's back, so it's working.
I know why. That's a good thing, because I think if I go to... So the camera needs to be active. That's something
okay.
I missed. But okay, so I will only show us or show... hopefully everything will work. I can fix that in the break.
Actually. Yeah.
So, yeah, but HTTP, you touched upon it in the last course. In this course, it's really important. We will work a lot with HTTP. We will not only use the come, get, and post.
No. And you will work with it in the first assignment as well, in the web scraper application. In this lecture, we're going to talk about more theoretical about HTTP and see how it works.
Yeah. And then it's up to you to in the assignment you will need to work with the HTTP verbs that we will talk about today. But you will kind of need to self find out how to work with it in the different environments. But, so we will talk about it on a more theoretical level. And since, as we said last week, Node is a platform upon which you can build more or less everything you like, and we will focus on web servers and focus on responses to HTTP requests.
Web applications will be the main part of the course, of course, and we're going to look at the framework express.js as a framework that helps us build web applications. And in this lecture, I think we're just going to show some sample codes, and we're coming back to the to Express in the next lecture more in depth.
Yep.
But just so you get a grip about what's it about.
Yeah, for the first assignment, it could be I guess it's, we don't have the requirement to use Express, but it could be needed to use it in the first assignment already.
But we will use it in the second assignment, so it's good to get the.
Okay. Yeah. So web servers. I mean, there's a lot of things to talk about web servers, and you can go into depth on like server management, and you could really, really dig into the web servers. And we just want to give you some kind of a brief overview of web servers. So we narrowed this down to four parts, more or less, that a web server is responsible for handling. And as we said in the last lecture, Node is not a web server, but you could use Node to create web servers if you like. And this is kind of what defines a web server. Okay, so it's a software that understands HTTP and HTTPS.
Yeah.
So it shows here that HTTP is important in this course, because, I mean, that's the main purpose of a web server. Then, I mean, modern web servers probably handle more protocols as well, not only HTTP.
No, we can have WebSockets and stuff like that. And what's HTTPS? We have talked about that a little.
Oh, we haven't actually, I think. But HTTPS is the secure layer of HTTP.
You put a layer above HTTP and you get a secure encrypted traffic.
Yeah.
We're going to go more into that when we go to the production part of this course, when we put our applications on our production server, and we're gonna use HTTPS.
Yeah, and we said, like in the last course, we said that many of the new APIs as well on the client depends on HTTPS. So knowing HTTPS and having HTTPS in your web applications is really important, and something that you will need to have more or less everything in public anyway.
Yeah.
If you publish a web application, you need to have it.
Today it's more than the default than using HTTP.
Going back to the 90s, the main purpose of the web server back then was serving static files, basically. Getting a request for a resource on disk, probably a HTML file or a picture or image or something like that, and just returning that static resource.
Yeah.
And I mean, all web servers have that ability.
Of course.
So, and we will see how this will. We will distinguish between static resources and dynamic resources later on.
And in a web application, there are a lot of static resources, files and images and scripts and stuff like that. So, the web server often handle all the resources and static resources. They serve a lot.
It's great when things just work out.
Yeah.
Like now we have sound on the screen as well.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jacob. One thing that is important in this course, of course, is serving dynamic content, not just static content, because static content, okay, like documents, is interesting, of course, but the web is built upon dynamic content on the client or on the server. And in this case, web servers classically has supported like PHP, ASP.NET, or whatever server-side technology. And what the server is responsible of doing is actually just, taking the request and dynamically fetching resources from databases or other servers and putting it all together into like a static file, like an HTML file, and sending it to the back to the client. So we have communication with databases. That will be an important
part. Especially in the second part where we're gonna build a what you call CRUD application, where you create, read, update, and delete resources in an application, and I'm going to use a database for that, and building a dynamic web application.
Yeah. And also sending requests to other servers will be an important part of the course, and it's an important part of every server.
Yeah.
What's a virtual host?
The thing about that is you often have a web server, but you have multiple domain names using, and you're using just one web server, and the web server has the ability to point the right domain names to the right resources. So you can use just one web server, but you can have multiple domain names. We call it web hotels.
Yeah. I don't know if, what's the English.
No, I don't know. But in Sweden we call it
hotel.
Yeah. And they often have one web server, but many customers with different domain names. So in most web servers you have the ability to what you call a virtual hosting also. We're not gonna talk too much about that in this course, I think, but it's good to know that you have.
So basically, that's it for web servers. We'll go into I missed some slides. It's difficult. I usually have a clicker, and the clicker always takes them in the right order. So yeah. So we have this slide as well. I will remove myself in a moment. So this is examples of web servers, basically. Apache is the classic web server. It's been here since the 90s. It's really, really, it's the most popular web server. You know, I think. Or is it IIS?
I think Apache in the last years have lost lots of market share to IIS and other web servers.
Yeah.
I don't have the recent figures, but I think Apache is you use Apache less.
Yeah, I think it was like 60% or something like that, so it might have changed actually.
I think it we say the A in the LAMP, so what's the LAMP?
Yeah, the LAMP is the Linux Apache
MySQL
and PHP stack.
And I think the usage of PHP is going down since we get a lot of other dynamic server script languages.
Yeah, so that's probably why Apache is losing as well. But I mean, it's a free server or open sourced anyway, and it's as you said, it's a really important server to have it together with PHP and MySQL.
But of course, you can use Apache for other stuff like you can use Ruby or other languages.
Yeah.
What was it? Do you know why it's called Apache?
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Or I want to know why. So the thing is, back when it started, it was like this server with a lot of functionality in it, and after a while, it just became this mess of patches. So they just added patches for everything, and that's why it's called Apache server.
Yeah.
So Apache server is a server with a lot of patches. So they had this like feather indicating the Apache Indians, I guess. So, but I don't think that's the original.
No, I heard the same as you said.
Yeah.
Apache server.
Yeah. Yeah. So many say Apache. I don't know in English. Apache.
Yeah.
Apache.
In Sweden, you can hear it.
Yeah. So, but I think the correct is Apache. But you could, challenge me on that one, I guess. Another popular web server is the IIS for Windows. It's been around since the 90s as well.
Mm.
It's not just a web server, it's a whole stack of like mail
different,
and FTP and a lot of services built into IIS.
Yeah.
But the web server, I guess, is the most
important. We often talk about it, that's IIS, when we talk about the web server. And that's the .NET platform, of course. Every kind of services they have in the .NET framework. I don't know so much about .NET, so...
No, but, I mean, it's like with every Windows product that they are in... I mean, they work really good together, and administer them in a good way, and...
And you're very tight coupled to the operating system,
yep.
The Windows system, so they are great at building interfaces for setting up the servers and stuff, because it's so integrated with the underlaying.
And .NET, of course, is a popular technology. I mean, hosting millions of web applications out there, and it's quite big in the more enterprise segment of web applications, server-side web applications. The Nginx, we will go into. Okay, do we have?
Jakob, send us a link for the web server, but you have to put it on your computer if you want to show it.
Ah, okay. So you can report back.
Yeah. So. You see the URL for the statics of the web server usage in the Slack channel.
Yeah. Sorry, live coding. If anyone is following us on live coding too, we have a private Slack channel for students asking questions, and that's because the live coding channel often get like invaded by non-students who are like trolling us. So that's basically why we're using Slack.
We had some questions in the live Slack. They thought the lecture would be in Växjö, but we said last time it would be here.
Yeah, and then you have like one place to sit in Växjö in this lobby-like area if you want to watch. Okay, so NGINX, we will touch upon that as well. Would you qualify it as a web server?
Yeah, among other things.
It's a lot of things. It's a multi-tool for...
Yeah. But I think most people will call it a web server. But in many cases you use it, as we said here, as a load balancer or a reverse proxy. Especially when we're using Node web applications, we put NGINX in front of it as a what we call a reverse proxy. But we coming back to that.
Yeah, we'll touch upon that. Yeah. Because NGINX is something you will probably use in this course. And then we have the Apache Tomcat. I haven't worked with that since like 2000.
Just one thing about NGINX and comparing to Apache. We have the Apache as a multi-threaded web server.
Yeah,
we talked the last lesson about how Node.js was working with the asynchronous event-driven approach. And it's the same. Apache is using the multi-threaded way to every request gets a new thread and stuff like that.
As well as IIS, I guess.
Yeah, I think so. But the NGINX is using more of the Node.js way with asynchronous event-driven approach. So that's an important thing.
Yeah, making it really good in handling a lot of requests and like being the spider that. A router that points some traffic to static resources, some stuff to Node or whatever. Yeah. And then we have the Apache Tomcat. As I said, I haven't worked with that since like 2002, but I guess it's still around, handling Java applications mainly.
Well, it's for the Java platform, I think. I think it's you add lots of components to the server. Handling the stuff you want, so you have the components for HTTP and GSP, Java server
pages,
to make the Tomcat handling HTTP request.
So for you in Växjö that has worked a lot with Java, I mean, if you're looking for writing Java web applications, Tomcat is probably the way to go.
Yeah.
The main actor of this course is Node.js.
Yeah.
So as we said,
is that not a web server? As we said.
Yeah. So it's a platform. It's not a web server. But we will see how to use it for creating web servers, basically.
But we when we come to the third part of the course, when we go and put our application on a server, we're gonna look into NGINX and setting up an NGINX also. So.
Yeah.
But we will write our application on the Node.js.
Yeah. So Node.js and NGINX is what we will use in this course.
Yeah.
So we got this picture. I will remove ourselves soon when we talk about cache that's beneath us. So this is basically some kind of image of a web application stack.
Yeah.
Or what we should call it. So the arrow. Over here, it's like, okay, so we get requests from like clients. It could be a web browser or even another server or whatever. So some of, we have talked about, or we have touched upon CDNs, content delivery networks, and basically some of the resources is not, there is no reason for those resources to like be stored in the database or something like that. So you have static resources.
Yeah, mainly static resources in the CDN, the image and stuff that could be cached for a long time.
Yeah, so and we want to cache those resources near the user.
Yeah.
So if we have an application running in Sweden, and we have a lot of American users, for instance, we really want the application to go fetch the resources as close as possible to the user.
Mm-hmm.
And that, well, that is what the CDN helps us with, that caching those resources near the user. So we have a CDN that has the resources cached in America, in Asia, everywhere. So
we have to buy servers everywhere and put on, or
yeah,
how does that work?
The thing is, in this case, that there are services doing this for us, Cloudflare or whatever.
Yeah. So you buy, and they have a content delivery network and have servers put everywhere in the world, and you pay them a fee and you upload your.
Yeah. Of course, you could. I mean. You could probably build your own like CDN for upon another cloud-based service like Amazon or if you like. But there are services that are focused on this.
So they are not in our internal network.
No.
They are put outside in the cloud here, the internet.
And then the traffic will come to some kind of reverse proxy or load balancer. We can start off with a load balancer, because in a big web application, you will get a lot of requests, and one server will not be able to handle all of those requests. So you need something, a load balancer, to look at those servers and see, okay, so the first server is actually free right now, or have a low usage, so we could forward traffic to the first server, and when that gets clogged, we could spread it out on the other servers as well.
Yeah.
And this is, this is something we have in the organization. It's not.
It's our internal network. We put the load balance.
And as you see here as well, I mean, it might not be so that we'll place all the static resources on in the CDN network. We could place them in a web server that is just built for handling static resources.
Yeah. So some stuff we do create during the user uploads images or stuff like that, that we won't, maybe won't.
That's a great example. If we have like a site where the user uploads a lot of images, it makes sense to place like some of the scripts and our graphical user interface or whatever in the CDN, but of course we cannot store all the users' images inside of the CDN. That would be hard to maintain and probably quite expensive, so we would need some way of serving static files as well. And that could be a web server that is just focused on serving static files, or we could use like Nginx for this, or even Node, I guess, telling Node to serve those static files. It's good if we separate those two, because, I mean, those servers over here that serves the dynamic content, they will be really clogged.
Yeah, and exactly. If you get a request for a static resource, you don't want to go the whole way through a framework, looking up stuff and
setting up database connections.
No, exactly, through the application server. So you have a clean passage to the static file. So just the request and make them the response in a quick way.
And then we have our application servers, or in our case, we will probably call them web servers.
Yeah, the reverse proxy, we talked a little about we could say this thing with the load balancer and reverse proxy, it could be an Nginx software running there. And the reverse proxy is more if you have different kinds of applications, or you, as we could see how you should put the redirect to a server for the static files. The load balance is more for the same application, so
balance on those application servers. Yeah.
More the reverse proxy, you have a couple of applications and you can reverse them through the right service in your network.
Yeah, so the reverse proxy is basically the one saying that, okay, this resource should go to the static web server, or is it? Yeah.
Yeah, you can put it up in the Nginx configuration, for example.
Yeah.
But another thing, we talk about proxy stuff, and we talk about reverse proxy, but we also talk about web proxy. Is that the same?
Yeah. So the concept of web proxies are further away from our application, basically.
Yeah. It's closer to the user.
Closer to the user. We will touch upon, well, not web proxies, that's cache, I think. But you could even have a proxy inside of your browser, if you like.
Yeah.
Or a proxy on your cooperation that caches things. I think at Elenium, for instance, we have an Elenium proxy that takes care and returns some sites immediately without updating them from the server. But that's another story, and we will not touch upon
yes,
that.
Yes, because when you read about proxies, you often read about web proxies. But you have web proxies closer to the user and reverse proxy closer to the application.
So going back to the application service or the web service, so this is basically Node in our case. So we will in Node create application service or web server that will handle all the dynamic responses. It could be like a user is trying to log in, a user is trying to query the database for some basic information, adding content or whatever. So dynamic operations will be handled by the web server or the web application. This will be the main focus of the course, even though we will touch upon everything we see in this picture, more or less. So when we have an application, we will probably need a database to store our data. So the data will be separated from the web server and the application server.
And we will probably use it in the same servers when we write in this course, because we just have one virtual server or something like that, but in many cases you have different machines just handling the database.
That's a good point. So ideally this would be a lot of servers, just like the picture.
But for
the sake of this, for this course, we will like have everything.
This is a picture more describing a big application with a lot of users. If you have a simple application with just a couple of hundred,
or even tens of thousands,
you probably won't use a load balancer, for example, and you maybe put the web application and the database application on the same server.
Yep. We have the external services as well, and that's more and more important for web applications today, to be able to contact external servers, querying for whatever data. It could be real-time data, it could be using APIs for getting some kind of data that is needed to execute the request.
Yeah, more and more what we call server-to-server communication. So servers communicate with another server to get data from another system or another kind of application.
You have written, I say you because you made the slide, but you've written micro inside the parentheses.
Yes. When we talk about, we will come into that in the next lesson more when we talk about web application architecture to make a short story of it, microservices is when you have a bigger application and you split it into different kind of services, different kind of smaller applications, we can say, and then your whole system will be communicating with the different microservices.
Yeah. And the last thing is the cache, because I mean we need to cache information.
Yeah.
In a big application, if we don't cache data, we will need to put a lot of money into hardware, basically.
Yeah.
Just adding more and more web and application servers to handle all our responses. If we could cache information instead of querying the database, for instance, it will...
Yeah, a lot of query you get to the database is the same. It's get the same data. So, of course, you can have an intelligent cache system to provide it in a very much faster way.
Yeah. You told me something about Reddit last year.
Yeah,
you remember? So you basically said that Reddit, in the big, you know Reddit, they have like something like 90% of all the requests are served from a cache.
And I guess if you have a good cache system, that's a very important thing when having a big application, so you can... You don't hit the database as often, not for the GET requests in a way.
No.
So, So most of the data GET request is served from the cache service instead.
We will not touch upon cache that much in this course.
Mm-hmm. That's a very big topic, and we will know that you can cache stuff, but we won't go into cache service and stuff like that in this course.
Yeah. And of course, I mean, in this picture, we have the cache here inside, more or less inside our application. But I mean, we have caches all the way to the user. That could be caches over the internet.
Yeah.
And
well, today we will talk about HTTP cache, the cache the web proxies will use.
Yeah.
So we come back.
We will touch upon that.
Yeah. How the HTTP protocol is using cache.
Let's get down to practice then, more or less, because
some code.
We could, right? So we need the ability to start a web server in Node, basically.
Yeah, because it's not a web server when you start Node, so you have to build an application that will serve as a web server.
Yeah. So hopefully you are quite familiar with JavaScript right now, and hopefully as ES6 as well, because we're using some ES6 code in this example, but should be quite straightforward. The first thing we need to do, as we said, Node is lightweight from start.
Yeah,
you need
it's
to like
small core.
Yeah,
yeah.
And you need to have modules to make things happen. I think the HTTP module though is a native module, right? So it's built in from the start. We don't need to install it.
The HTTP.
Yeah.
No. It's,
so it's like FS or
exactly.
It's a system module.
Yeah.
So we just require the HTTP module, and in this case we use the HTTP.create server to create in this case create the web server.
Yeah. And that's.
That's pretty much that.
You have a web server that responds to. It could take requests. And it could send back response, as you see in the parameter list.
Yeah. So this is the callback that will be called as soon as we get a request to the server,
exactly.
And as parameters we get the request object and we get the response object, and the request object will hold all information about the request.
Yeah. Exactly.
And we can use the response object to send the response back.
Yeah.
And that's basically what we are doing here. We are sending a response, right head 200. So this is the HTTP verb for or HTTP status code for saying that everything went okay.
Yeah.
And we are ending the response and sending data.
Yeah.
In this case,
yeah,
says hello world.
Yeah.
After we created it, we also. It's not enough to create it. We also need to start it, and we do that by the listen command.
Yeah, of course, a web server should open up a port on the machine, and in most cases, the HTTP is using port 80.
Yeah.
But when you develop, in this case, we're using 8080, and in most cases, when you sit, you have a reverse proxy that's point to a different port. And the reverse proxy is listening to the port 80 or 443 the HTTPS port.
So basically, let's try out this example. Now I have a lot of stuff on my computer, so to sanitize myself here. Let's just click on some things. I will show you soon. And I think you have those demos on. They are available on the.
Not yet.
Not yet. They will probably
maybe
be available.
Yeah.
So let's just close this down. So. So if we change back to this view, you will see that we have.
It should be the same code, yeah.
More or less the same. I've changed the port 8000 instead. That's just because we are serving this from Vagrant, and that was the port that was forwarded inside of Vagrant. So this is basically it. Let's have a look in this. Just have a look in this folder. We have some more stuff. We have the package.json. In this case. doesn't say much because
we have no dependencies.
No, so it's just more or less a start.
The thing it says is that you can write npm start to execute the command.
Yeah, node, npm run start, right?
I think you can use.
It's a short term for
You don't have to use run.
Yeah, or start. That's pretty much that. So let's.
So in this case, we don't need to do any npm install, as we talked about the last.
We don't.
Oh, do we?
It's a trick question, right?
We don't have any dependencies.
Yeah, we need to do that. We need to do it, right? Or no?
I don't think we do. But you can do it if you want to show off.
Yeah, we did. But why did we?
Because you don't have to install any.
Why do I have? What do we have in our mode? No, it's empty. Yeah.
Yeah. Because you don't have any requirements you need.
So this is basically it. Package, readme, and the server.js.
Yeah.
Yeah. So node, start. NPM start.
If you want to use NPM start, but you. Okay.
Let's try it. Yeah. Works.
So it executed a node server.js. Yeah, it's the same.
Yeah, so we could have node server.
Exactly.
If we want. So the server is running. Of course, when we start listening, we could have something saying that the port is. Or the server is started listening on board a.
Yeah,
of course. Like we did not do that.
And how to? And you can use the console.log.
Yep.
To write it out in the terminal.
Yeah. So actually we could.
We could do that.
Yeah. No. Let's do like a two step. So first of all, let's go to the browser and just see what happens if we go to the local host. So basically we get the hello world.
Yeah.
If you were to look inside of that's not a good thing.
No,
we should
take view source.
My God, how do I do this in full screen? That's really hard.
Remove full screen.
How did that go? That was Visa C Shell. So that's view source. And if we view the source of this response, we see that it only says hello world.
Yeah, it's just text in this case, so it's a not complete HTML document.
It's two rows because I think we have a backslash m response. So, but if you look in inspect, you will see that we have a HTML and the body and what? And the
what
table,
you do?
What's this? Yeah, so this is basically just the browser seeing that some idiot is trying to view an HTML page and it's actually just text. So it will add all of in this
if
case,
you have plugins installed or stuff,
we are actually inspecting the view source. So, like that. So we get it right. So, yeah, but basically it's the same. So we have the body and we have a pre that is added and we have the hello world. So actually the browser is doing work for us because we are not doing it properly.
No.
Of course we are going to serve the whole HTML page.
We will come into that.
Yeah. Let's go back to Atom and have a look at I will just try to do this. So every time we get a request, we will do a login saying someone said hi, something like that.
Save
it and we just reload the page. So I reload the page and we go back to terminal and nothing happened. Why?
Whoa, you have to restart the application because it's for every change you do, you have to restart the node application to get it work.
Yeah.
And that could be a pain in some case because you try stuff out and you have to restart everything. So there are tools to help you. One is Nodemo.
Yeah.
I think that can watch the changes in the files and automatically restart the server. So you can use Nodemon for that.
Yeah, and if you're coming from like an environment where you have PHP, for instance, you probably used to just saving the file
and
exploding. And that's, they are completely different architectures in the servers. Mm-hmm. So this one, the node server, is caching quite a lot in memory.
Just like it compiles it.
So I will just restart it.
Control C.
And reload, and going back, we see that someone said hi. Mm-hmm. So you
and you see in the terminal the console log is coming out.
Yeah. So sometimes you like want to throw errors in your code. Should we try that?
Yeah. Do that.
So something will go wrong. So we are doing it like that. Remember, we start the server, and we are doing new.
Yeah, but it's okay.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, it failed. But I threw the error before we ended the response. That's why. Yeah. So what this does is we are not handling the error right now.
No.
And if an error is being thrown and we're not handling it, the whole application crashes basically. And you do not want this to happen on
the
browser.
No, because as you see, if you go up in another browser window or another client comes, the application is down.
Yeah,
that's correct. It's
just down.
Yeah, so that's not a good thing for web applications. No.
So of course, you should always handle errors. You should have a catch that takes care of the error, maybe logs it, or some way takes care of the error.
If there are what you call an unhandled error in your code somewhere, you should always wrap everything in a try catch or something that handles that error, so you never...
I'm in the way. Damn it, it's hard to remember to... you see that. Another way to handle it is...
I'm just talking about coming later, but when we go to production, we can use what we call process managers that automatically, when an error handles, it automatically restart the application. So if we have some bug, the whole system shouldn't go down, so it could restart. We have one called, we will use the one called PM2, that's a process manager that helps us with a lot of things among this.
Forever is another popular tool that you will come in contact with if you Google problems like this. Basically handle your errors first of all, and second of all, have a process manager that handles those kinds of problems. So that's it. Let's see, where are we in the lecture? We're going over to HTTP. I think we should have a break.
Yeah, it will be fine.
And if you have questions, you can always ask them in Slack. So we will answer them.
We'll try to pick them up.
Yeah.
How long?
Did I connect the outro to a bound?
I don't know what you did.
Let's see. So 15 minutes break. Oh, fresh coffee in the mugs. We're back.
Yeah.
We got some questions in the break regarding more practicalities concerning the course. Are we going to Växjö on Wednesday on the tutoring session, for instance? Are we?
No, we aren't. So we take the tutoring as we did last time. A connect room. We find it on the course webpage and using Skype. For those of you who have questions.
So we will be in the Connect room and we will monitor it during the tutoring session and we will call you up on Skype. So just provide us with your Skype ID. And that's because, as we said in the course introduction, this is actually a camera course.
Exactly. But
we will try to do it so it works for everybody. So we are not having lectures here in Kalmar either, live.
No.
We are doing it like this, and I hope this will work for everyone. If you have some connection, I know some people sometimes have connection issues with Wild Coding TV. If you have, first of all, please let us know, and second of all, we will remind you that everything's recorded and you will have this on YouTube.
Maybe tomorrow.
Course webpage. Yeah. But any questions or stuff, write it down in the Slack channel so we can take it from there.
Yeah, so switching topics from web service, or well, we will touch upon web service now as well. So we are actually looking at an image here. This is Switzerland and France, I guess. This is the CERN, the research center with a big particle accelerator. And this is where it all started. I think I told you some of the history when we in the last course when we discussed HTML and CSS, because this is where it started. So, and it started with this guy, Tim Berners-Lee.
Or sir,
I must say sir, of course.
It should be.
What's he called? He's royally crowned, or no, not crowned. That's only the queen. what's he called? He's sir.
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 Noble or
knight?
Maybe.
So Tim Berners-Lee, he worked on CERN as a researcher.
I think he was a developer,
developer.
And he was managing systems for documentation, because the lots of research science stuff, documents, reports and articles and stuff like that, so they needed a good system for handling the documentation.
They had like this big mainframe, I think, where you had to like apply for doing searches in the mainframe. Quite a hassle.
And he was interested in working with system handling, how can we provide documentation and how to save it and how to search for it and stuff like that. So I think he worked mainly as more a programmer, but I think he has a degree in physics or whatever.
But basically, he produced this like paper to the management saying that this is a proposal for how to manage information in CERN.
As he worked with different kind of documentation systems, he gets some inspiration from a lot of other guys. Should we name some names? But we have. Ted Nelson, I think, is a good, who was the guy talking about hyperlinks or hypermedia and stuff like that. He mentioned it first, and he had some inspiration from a guy called Vannevar Bush, I think, and who wrote a paper back in the 40s or 30s, maybe. So he get a lot of inspiration from that and come up with a kind of documentation system using hyperlinks technology and that term, and he wrote this paper.
Information management the proposal.
I
love the thing that his boss wrote in the popcorn is that vague but exciting.
I think it was he didn't get to work with it so much. But in the end, his boss gave him the opportunity to put some labor into this system or documentation system, and he got able to get started to work.
So he started to present when he got this working. He started presenting it at different conferences, and slowly the train picked up and. In colleges or universities,
and of course they start using it at CERN.
Where
the system.
This is basically where the web started. As we said before, and we will see soon that we need to separate the concept of the web and internet, because internet was in place back in the 90s, of course. It was quite well connected, but mainly for other usages, not the web as we know it, for mail and different kind of file transfers and stuff like that. Okay, so back to the web. This is the foundation of the web. He created the HTTP protocol and he created HTML for presenting information.
On a very early version. So.
Yeah. So we have this kind of chair.
Three-legged
stool, presenting the with three legs, presenting the three legs of the web.
Yeah, the main concepts that the web is about. We got HTTP, of course. We got the HTML as a mock-up language, and we got the URI. We call all as maybe we say more
URL,
which is some. Thing of the URI.
Yeah, URI is a broader term of addressing.
Addressing resources. Yep. So we got the way to get resources. We got the way to technically transport, getting from a client to a server and stuff like that. And we got the way to make the presentation in a good way.
Yep.
So these are your standards.
Yeah.
He built.
Yeah.
Which the web and blah blah blah.
Yep. And as I said before, today the web has broadened. So it's not that simple to say that the web is HTTP, HTML, and URI. No. Or URLs. We have those other protocols as well. So, but this is still
It's important
foundation.
Exactly. One thing we can talk. Why do you think web in this time there were a lot of other applications? We had technologies like Gopher and stuff like that could have been the web
as we know it.
Yeah, but why do you think Tim Berners-Lee succeeded?
He did one thing that was, that was important and was great, and that was that he basically released everything.
Exactly.
So he has said that, okay, use this as you like. The other systems have like those licenses and
models. If you look at the Gopher system that was very big at this point, I think they sent a mail to, or said in some way that maybe in the future we will maybe take a little fee, a small fee
for
maybe the server stuff. Yeah. And think about the web, if you had to pay a fee for every web server,
every
you put
transaction,
up.
Or every request.
So that the users were frightened about that and went. And I think Tim Berners-Lee said that was the main thing.
Yeah.
And all this, you get lucky. You the idea came at the right time and stuff like that. Mm. And you get the big number of users using. But the free stuff, I think that's very important to remember.
Yeah. And, URLs, we have discussed them earlier on the client side. HTML, of course, took it together with CSS. CSS wasn't in place at the start. It came later, but we now know how to separate those concepts. So we will leave the green and the blue in this picture. We will leave them for now, and we will focus on the HTTP for the rest of this lecture. So, I missed this one. Mm-hmm. So, what's this?
I think it's the world's first web server ever.
Yeah, the HTTP daemon.
Exactly. So, you see the note, this machine is a server, don't power down. Do not power down. So, that's the machine that held all the documents in the sun, I guess.
Yeah, and we see that it's an old Next machine. It was like Steve Jobs' first or the computer that led up to, I think, the OS X, for instance. Mac that was, I think they merged or something. I don't know the history that much.
Yeah, Google the story.
Yeah. So, moving on. What's this? This is like the first web page. We have seen it in the last course, so we will dwell upon it. But basically, what we need you to know right now is that the purpose of this was basically just to serve static resources using links. That was
exactly
the main purpose, and that was how the HTTP protocol was built and was built for.
And the main thing, it was easy to create, easy to link resources. So you can use the hyperlinks and just click your way surfing the web,
yeah,
as we know. And this was a very good thing when talking about a hard structure for documentation and stuff like that and finding stuff. So it may not look as much, but it was, I guess, was pretty amazing.
Yeah, add some CSS to it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So if you want to know more about this or the story behind the web, I think we could recommend this Weaving the Web book, right? Steve Berners-Lee's thoughts about what we talked about right now.
Yeah,
how the
started. Yeah, exactly, the background, the people involved.
The philosophy.
Yeah, it was not just one man show, as we say, it was more people involved and yeah, the history, the story about creating the web.
So Weaving the Web with Tim Berners-Lee.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's have a look at the introduction to HTTP then. So this is the TCP/IP model. This is basically a model for describing network traffic in applications.
Internet traffic.
Yeah, and you have different models. This is the TCP/IP model. That's a simplification of like the OSI model, that's more complicated, but this is good enough for us. So what we want to show with this picture is that, I mean, the thing that Tim Berners-Lee came up with was this, the HTTP protocol, that is part of the application layer in this stack. So
yeah, so you can see that the internet was there. Yep. You can just put your application protocol on top of, and it will work with all the existing network.
Yeah, and in the back, in the bottom. Oh, this is in Swedish. I didn't see that.
Oh, yeah.
But it says network, so
yeah,
you
can
probably guess that it's pretty close. So in the bottom we have the network, the physical network. We have the cables, and we have the technology for
Ethernet.
Exactly, transmitting binaries over the network, and then we have the IP version or the IP model upon that, with addressing functionality of IP. So this is where your IP address basically resolves. And as we see, we have the version 4, that's the normal one, the one we are using. IPv6 is coming, it's been coming for years.
Yeah.
It's a really, really big thing to upgrade all the network components on the internet to support IPv6. And this is mainly because IPv6 has so many more addressing possibilities than IPv4.
Yeah.
So that's basically it. And upon IP, we have the TCP or UDP, and this is more or less, when we say TCP/IP, this is what we mean.
Exactly. And we, in this course, we mainly go to TCP, Transport Protocol.
Yeah.
So it handles all the stuff when you connect to a server, taking care of that each TCP package, when it come back, you put them together in the right order and stuff like that.
And we will focus more or less entirely on the application protocol, or application protocols, in this case HTTP. But you see other protocols like DNS, SMTP, or Torrent, or whatever internet application that has its own protocol is on this part of the stack.
Yeah.
So, we are back to that one. I'm not sure what we were supposed to say.
Yeah, the thing is, what we have to remember is when Tim Berners-Lee created the web, he couldn't imagine what the web would be today. So the main standards and stuff, he had this thing in mind.
Yeah.
But as we will see,
we have evolved since then.
Yeah. So that's why HTTP looks like it looked like.
Okay. So back to this model, you've seen it before, the client-server model with the request and the response, and there are some things to be noted here. So, first of all, this is stateless, and with stateless we mean that every request is, I mean, the server will not remember the state of the application between the requests, so the server will not know when the client reconnects that we already had a discussion. It will be like every request will be its unique state, more or less.
And that could be a very good thing, because you just the server just handles the request, sends it back, and then forget you don't have any overhead.
You don't need to have a thread going and save state memories
and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So, and that's the main thing about the web server, just providing content. So many clients could connect and get their content.
Yeah, and it works really good with this model.
Yeah,
I mean.
Get a link
and forget about all the rest. That's one thing what we need to consider in this course. And the second one is that HTTP has no built-in security.
Yeah, of course. When Tim Berners-Lee created this, of course you were on CERN. Everyone trusts each other.
Yeah.
We don't have any problem with security. People like to hack your server or do bad stuff because they all have the same goal and trusted each other.
Yeah.
So no built-in security in the HTTP protocol.
No. And that's why we have the HTTPS protocol, or the secure layer upon HTTP. Yeah.
We don't need to encrypt our traffic or stuff like that because exactly they trusted each other.
Looking at some of the versions of HTTP, it started out in 91 with a 0.9. I guess it started even earlier, but this is what's documented. And then moving on to 1.0, that's the first real, when the web grew.
Yeah.
And HTTP 1.1 is probably the one the most used today, and
I would think
since the 90s. So that they had improvements over the 1.0, but it didn't happen much since 97 until last year.
Earlier,
but last year it happened, and that's that we got the HTTP2. And this, I mean, might not seem like a big thing for developers, because it's just this HTTP, whatever, I don't care. I want to create web applications, but as we will see, it will affect the way we write applications in some extent.
In some other extents,
maybe not, but to some extent it will. So that's the landscape. And today, I would say that HTTP 1.1 is the most used. I think so.
But if you're using a modern browser, surfing to a big
modern
page.
Application like
Facebook, Twitter, you probably use HTTP2 because it's all right to implement it.
Yeah.
Modern browsers, I think we watched before, Safari had
some issue.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't support HTTP2 over not secure connection, so you need to have a HTTPS.
But the other browsers are supporting it, and every web server application, I think, or software have some module running HTTP2, so it's not hard to implement.
And even later versions of the Internet Explorer are supporting it.
But if you analyze the traffic from your client to a server, I think most of them using HTTP 1.1.
Yeah.
Because we have, as you've seen, it's a lot of machines and servers between the client and the server, and proxies maybe don't understand HTTP 2 and stuff like that. So have some. You probably will use it more.
So. Okay, let's get on and look at HTTP methods first of all. You have seen some of those before, I guess. Those are called verbs, so something you can do with the server.
Yeah, you can call them verbs, methods, action. I've seen also HTTP actions.
Yeah. Different names for the same thing.
Yeah.
And the most popular ones is get and post. And I guess that's because those are built into the HTML components natively, like the form controller, for instance, have support for get and post, but maybe in the later versions even patch and delete. Or
I think in an early version of HTML5, I think they put input and delete.
Okay,
also, but they removed it.
Okay, so,
so
probably was some discussion about that. I guess.
Yeah, but if you using Ajax or stuff like that, you can easily send a other thing that and then get the
using the XML HTTP
desktop. Exactly.
You are able to say what word you want to use and we have a bunch. We should address them. So looking at this table, we see some words here. So first of all, we need to clear what's this idempotent is. I'm not even sure I'm pronouncing it correct. But
idempotent, I think it's pronounced. Well, that has the internet is a unsecure network, meaning that you can lose the connection to the server. And what idempotent means is that a GET request, for example, is you can send a GET request many times, like you're refreshing your page when you don't get the answer back, and it won't change the resource.
Yeah.
A POST is not idempotent, so when you do a POST, if you build a bad application, you can reload your POST page and
It will
send a form date again, and maybe in the worst case produce new resources on the server every time. So that's what idempotent stands for, and you see that the different verbs have some of them are idempotent and some are not. So it could be good to know about.
Making the difference between post and put, for instance. So post is supposed to create a new, say for instance a new resource like a person in a register or something like that, and put is supposed to update a person that is already in the register.
But you can have a discussion about that because in the standard put can also say that it create resources. But the thing is that put. Often, when you send a put, you often send a identifier of a resource, and the server don't see, I don't have a resource with this identifier. Say a put create a blog or something, and you send a put with a unique ID, and the server don't have a blog with that ID, it will create it.
So it
can be used as
but often I use it as an update.
And
that's why put is idempotent, because it will, the result of a put action will always be the same. You will have this blog with this ID, even if it wasn't there from the beginning or it got updated.
And if you get two in a row, it will be the same resources because, I have already created it. Now I'm updating with
the same data.
Whereas
post will create new ones.
You don't send an ID and the server will take it and create a new generating the new ID for the resource, you can say.
Yeah, got it. And
this, you talk a lot about this when you talk about REST APIs, web APIs, where you send different kind of verbs to the server and creates resources and stuff.
So I guess this is one of the things all the Rastafarians are
debating
about.
Yeah, exactly, how to use these verbs.
Post, pardon. And we have patch as well.
Yeah, it's a new one. I think they added it to the standard now. It was an extended thing in the standard. And that's more a partial update of the resource. So you don't have to send input. You should send all fields in a resource. So if you have a blog, you have the name and the author and stuff like that. In a patch, you can just send the ID and the stuff you want to update, so it's smaller messages. So in real APIs, when using them, they have support for patch. But in most cases, put and patch is the same.
Yeah, more or less.
Yeah.
Delete speaks for itself, basically. To delete the resource, whatever. If you're used to writing PHP, or at least when I wrote PHP applications back in, what was it, early 2000, the classical way was like having a delete button in a form, and the server looked at the post and saw that, okay, so someone clicked the delete button, then we are converting the post action to a delete action in practice.
Yeah, and exactly, and that's the way you do it today when you're using HTML forms. Often you have a field underscore method, and you have a framework looking at that and handle it. You set the method to delete, and you know the framework know how to handle
to handle it later on. Okay.
If you look in Ruby, Ruby on Rails, yeah, they have that kind of,
I
think most frameworks have. We will see it in the express.js too.
But in this case, we have the opportunity to use delete all the way, but then we have the client that might have limitations.
Yeah.
But if we are, for instance, if we are writing a server-to-server communication.
Yeah, or if you have a web API,
then
you don't render out HTML, you're just using JSON or stuff.
Mm.
So you send the delete, HTTP delete, and the server can handle it. So, but we are focusing on HTML forms in this second part of the course.
Yeah.
So, it's good.
We have had the options as well, and had this. That's when you want to get some information about a resource.
Mostly at times.
Do I use it a lot? I don't think so.
You don't use your head a lot.
No. Funny guy.
Yeah. Well, just checking stuff.
Yeah. And the options you can see that when it says course, for instance. So I guess the option is checking. As it says, checking what the server can do or what commands are available on the server, like course, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
You can inspect the network traffic in your browser and see this verb being used. We didn't touch upon those with safe and unsafe. What's that?
You could say the verb that change resources. You call them unsafe, and probably should have some authorization for making this request in your backend.
So the verbs are the first part of that's one important part of knowing HTTP.
Yeah, and important to know from the client to the server.
Yeah,
that's in our request we have the method.
Yeah, we will have a look at the headers later on. So next thing to know is the status codes, and this is like, okay, we get a request and we send a code back with information about the request the handling of the request, I should say.
Yeah.
So was it successful? Couldn't I do what I was supposed to do, or have you on the client made something wrong?
Yeah, telling the client how things went and give some information how to fix it if it went wrong.
Yeah, and I mean, most people know a lot of those codes already.
Yeah.
I mean, the 404 is a classic. Classic resource not found, but I would say it's not important to know all the status codes, but it's important to know, I think, the 100th number, so to speak.
So what kind of message the server is responding.
So the first number is indicating that. So we see like the 100 spectra is for informational purposes.
Yeah.
So like this 101, we saw this in Windows and WebSockets, for instance. That
exactly.
When we change from HTTP to WebSocket, we get a 101 since we keep protocols. This one is, you don't see that as much as 200, for instance. That is a successful command being executed. Like, okay, everything went fine. The 200, that's the normal one when you're getting a resource.
But the server understand the request and did what it was supposed to do. Yeah.
But working with the HTTP verbs, for instance, like post, if we post something to the server, it's quite neat if the server not just says okay, it could even say okay, I created a resource.
Exactly.
So
and coming back to building RESTful web APIs, that could be a good thing, because you as a client you analyze this. Two or four no content for instances, then it just tells you that it's okay, and the client don't have to look in the body for
no,
any
because,
more.
Yeah.
It will not be any content, it's just an okay. Mm-hmm. And as you said, they created telling it, okay, you send a post and it went well, I created this resource.
And even maybe it gives the URI for the resource.
Yeah,
or the
resource
header,
in the body.
Body in JSON format or whatever.
That depends.
Yeah. The 300 spectrum is redirection. You have probably seen it. You're visiting one site and the URL is magically changing to another.
Yeah. And that's how it's important to know if you get a redirection that the browser will look in the location header. We're coming back to headers and stuff like that, but when you get a redirection, you will look in the location header and see where to go. So the browser in do it automatically.
Yeah.
It just follows the link. But it could be good to know in the assignment.
Yeah, maybe things we say actually
can
be used in the assignment.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah. So the 400 client errors, I think it's really important to know the difference between 400 and 500 spectrum, because they are both signaling errors.
Yeah.
But 400 spectrum kind of says that probably the client did something wrong.
Yeah.
Like a bad request, for instance, that, okay, I'm responding, everything is working on my side, says the server, but you are sending a bad request. I cannot do what you're telling me to do.
Don't send every data the server needed or in bad format or stuff like that.
Mm. We also see we have the unauthorized and we have the forbidden.
Yeah.
And those could be quite confusing, right?
Yeah.
I mean, what isn't that the same thing?
Yeah, you can think so. You have the unauthorized, that's telling that the authentication went bad, which is some...
You tried to log in and you had a
wrong password, wrong username and stuff like that.
Mm.
So it should have been called what should you call it? Hard in English.
No, I think it's right, unauthorized.
But authorized could also be when you're trying to get a resource and you have logged in but you're not.
No! That's unauthorized. Yeah, I'm mixing them up. So it should be
unauthenticated
or unauthenticated.
Yeah.
Unauthenticated. Yeah. So
Swedish guys.
Yeah. Unauthenticated instead of unauthorized.
Yeah.
So
that could be confusing. And we're coming back to that when we will talk about security and how to build login system and stuff like that. But when you are logged in and trying to get a resource, you don't. Not have the privilege to get, you get a forbidden instead.
Yeah, so actually 403 should have been unauthorized.
I think so.
401 should have been
whatever he
said. Yeah, whatever. Like I said before. So, yeah, leaving the client errors, the 500 spectra is the server errors. For instance, the database, we cannot reach the database, something crashed.
Unhandled error or stuff like that.
I mean, 500 errors should basically never reach the client. We should have things handling this. But I mean, it could even be the load balancer just flipping out.
Or we're trying to request from an external source that's going down.
And we are getting it for 500 back, and then we know that, okay, we didn't, at least we didn't, presumably didn't do anything wrong. However, in the real case, it's often so that, okay, we are doing something wrong on our side that the server cannot handle, so it generates an error on the server.
Yeah.
So in the long run, it's our fault, so to
speak,
the origin of the error is on the client, but yeah, that's hard to... It's hard to cover every corner when writing a server application. That's probably what I'm trying to say. Okay, so looking at headers. This is an example of headers from example.com. It's an HTTP 1.1 header, as we see in the top. This is probably, it's not a new one. You can tell by looking at the version numbers, I think, on the user. But whatever, it's...
Yeah, one important thing to know is, okay, this is a HTTP header, and it's plain text. Sending them in, so you can always check them up in the inspector and stuff like that.
So the first one, client to server. So the client sends this request to the server, to the host, and telling the server a lot of things. For instance, we will get into those, I guess.
We call them HTTP headers. Host connection, and you see the format of them: the name of the header, a colon, and then the information.
Yep.
You can take user agent, for example, that you probably used in the client course.
So we are telling the server that we are in Mozilla 5.0 on the Macintosh, yada, yada, yada. Yes. I mean, back in the days, this was important information to tell the server, so the server could render different pages depending on different clients. However, of course, we shall not do that, and we cannot even trust this user agent, because, I mean, it could be spoofed, we could say whatever we like in this one. And we had the whole problematic with, like, Internet Explorer trying to say that it is a Mozilla to be let into to certain sites. So, yeah, but that's an example.
So this is getting the website route on example.com.
And the server replies. So yeah, I found the web route. I respond with 200. Okay, we have some information about the content that we sent back. In this case, it's text/HTML. And what we do not see in this header, it's not in the header, but below this header in the message, we will see the content of the resource being asked.
Probably HTML.
Yeah,
in this case. So. Or it could be JSON, or it could be text, or whatever.
Yeah. So the browser will parse and remove the content or the header before presenting the content to the browser. So custom headers. I mean, this is headers which are defined by the specification. We could use header information not specified in the
it's just a list of things. Some could be in the standard, but you can, since you can control the client code and the server code, you can add your own custom headers, and you can name them in a way so you can take them in your application and see. You can see, for example, we have a web API, and we have only the client could only use amount of requests. The client could send that this is the
server will probably respond saying, okay, you have used 500 requests, you have only 200 left. With a timestamp or something like that. Yeah.
So depending on your own application, you can add custom HTTP headers.
Yeah. Is it good practice or is it bad practice?
Well, in many applications or web API you see, they are using many things. What you can say is that there were a rule when you were creating your own custom headers that you used on big X in front of them, so you can say this is a custom header. But that some of these custom header that big companies were taking into the standard, and then they removed the X, and then all the old applications don't work with the new one, and you get
to support both the X and without the X.
So you don't recommend that anymore. No. But you are free as long as you don't make any mistakes or taking the same name that are used in the standard, it's okay.
Yeah. Okay, so moving on. No, sorry. This is an example looking at...
I think we have to speed up a bit. 5 minutes left.
So this is a client-to-server header up here, just saying, so this is accept, for instance. but this is just an example of saying that the client says that, okay, I accept text HTML, I probably want text HTML, but I will be fine with application slash XHTML and XML, or application slash XML if that's fine. This is just some weights for how to...
The client could ask the server in which format it's supported.
In this case the client says, okay, I support those. Send me the data back in some of those formats, and the server will choose. In this case, saying, okay, I will encode, for instance, my data. I will zip it with gzip because the client supported gzip or deflate or sdch. And in this case, the gzip was chosen. So that's just an example of that. MIME types, we haven't touched upon those, but it's important to know this is called a MIME type. So this is basically a string telling what kind of text is being sent. So it's text, it's plain text with a character set of UTF-8, but what does the text represent? It could be a text slash JavaScript, if it's a JavaScript file, it could be JSON, it could be whatever. But it's important in some cases for the client to know what is the data we are communicating. It could be an API, for instance. You are sending back data. Is the data in JSON or XML format, for instance? Why shouldn't you? You say that you should only gzip text files if they are bigger than one.
You gzip stuff, you're using the CPU cycles, and it's not.
When it's
optimized.
More data, you will not gain anything, and really small files will even grow. So.
Yeah. But in most cases, the web servers have the default stuff that are optimized for this kind. But you can change it on the server.
Other things to bear in mind: user agents, for instance. I talked about them. Never trust them because they are. Easy to spoof, but in this context, I think it's important to say that, for instance, if you write a web scrape or writing something, contacting an API or whatever, identify yourself.
Yeah.
Say that, okay, so I'm a scrape, I even have contact information.
Yeah,
the
email address.
Yeah.
If you're building a web spider or a web scrape or something like that, Put your email address in the user agent.
And it could even be a good thing, because I mean you think you need to scrape a web page, for instance. So you're scraping the web page, and this is slowing the web page down, and then the administrators of the page are seeing that, oh, we are getting scraped, and they see your email address in the requests, and then they could even contact you and say, oh, so see, you are interested in our data, we have an API, please use this instead. So it could be a good thing. But of course, if you're a bad person, you can just leave it empty, so we cannot trust them.
But we should be good.
Yeah, we should be good persons. So authorization, there are some basic authorization built into the HTTP protocol.
I think we leave it for now, and
we
will, coming back to that.
We will have a security session later on.
Of course, we don't have so much time left.
The same thing is with the server. So the server go back to this one. The server says some information about itself, basically.
Yeah.
Many say that you should change it so you don't leak what kind of server you are, because if you are leaking that you are a node server or an NGINX or whatever, people doing attacks against your server will have information. So maybe you should hide it, saying, I am the Joyable Server 3.0 whatever.
But you can always figure out.
You will find other ways to figure that out. So mainly stopping script cases. So we said that it was stateless.
Yeah.
But how could we have login if we have a stateless protocol? We need some way of managing the state, even though the HTTP is stateless. And this is where sessions come in handy. So we need something that synchronizes between the client and the server. For instance, we could, with every request to the server, we could send like an ID and a username telling the server that, oh, it's us, we are trying to communicate with you. Yeah. So the server could look at this and...
Using the Cure stream stuff, so the server can watch what's after the question mark.
Yeah, so this is basically not the optimal way of doing it. No. Maybe some applications, but not everywhere. Cookies is a really, really popular way of doing this.
Yeah.
Having IDs in the server is setting a cookie on the client, and the client will send this cookie to the server all the time with this unique ID. That's
the way we're going to look at the login system. And maybe it's the way you have to work with it in the assignment too.
Yeah.
Try to remember that you have a login system and you're going to scrape it, you're going to automate it with your script, and the server expects a cookie, it will send you a cookie and you will send it back.
Yeah.
And a tip could be that you look in the libraries using the request libraries. They probably have some support of handling cookies.
I mean, it could be cumbersome to do it yourself, so take use of the tools.
Yeah, exactly. But that's a good thing to know, because if you don't send a cookie, you won't get the information you're trying to scrape, so you have to think about it.
And JSON Web Tokens, I think we will maybe get back to that later. So basically, in the response to the client, we will set a cookie, and in this case, we will have some PHP session ID with some random string and some path that we will use somehow in the server. In this case, it's probably just to say that it's for this path on the application. And when the client requests our resource, it will send this PHP session ID, and we will look at this one. However, we see a flaw here if we're using HTTP, because this is sent over the network. And if someone looks at the network traffic, and it could be in a router or whatever, it could be over unencrypted wireless network, not that common anymore, but could. It's quite common actually. So someone could pick this session ID up, and if we get the session ID, we could impersonate ourselves to be this client, so we could get full access to whatever resources the client is using. So using this kind of session handling, of course, you should have HTTPS when you are doing this, but we will look at that in coming lectures as well.
I think we will jump this.
Yeah, the cache. We will.
The main thing to remember is that the HTTP protocol have headers for controlling the cache, and all the web proxies and stuff like that could look and determine how to cache stuff.
Yeah.
Should I cache it or should I not? Is this private? So only the browser should cache it and stuff like that. And the HTTP protocol have these kind of headers built in. So watch the slides. I think they explain.
Maybe you have some external resources as well.
There are document explaining.
We should just touch upon this really, really quick.
Yeah.
And that's the flaws of the HTTP 1.1 protocol. This was supposed to have this stateless sending, just opening a TCP connection, sending back data, closing the TCP connection, and that's it. However, modern web applications are using a lot of resources at the same time. And if you you have a picture down here. No, it's really far away. There, yeah. So this is just querying a newspaper in Sweden, and we get like 758 requests just for looking at the start page. And HTTP wasn't designed for this.
No.
Also you have the problem with if you are sending a request, this is a big request, so it will take a long time to respond, and you have a smaller request at the same time you're trying to send, because you can send like 8 requests or something like that
on
an open TCP connection. So then all of those connections, they will have, the server will handle those in order. And we need to wait for the first request to respond before we can process the other ones.
So. And if that request takes time, it's blocking the rest of the stuff that you could send.
Yeah. So having this model is not optimal.
It's good to know that HTTP isn't a good protocol for relying on the TCP, because TCP is wanting the request to open up a socket and doing the transport over time, having a socket open. The HTTP is request response, the server close down the connection after the request.
So in this case, Hermione is quite suspicious. Why can't we just like add bandwidth, basically?
Yeah.
Just speeding up connections and it will be fine, or?
Or?
Well. So, if in theory, we could, like, adding more bandwidth will speed up pages, but only to an extent, so we have this latency. So just adding bandwidth will not help us to get rid of the latency.
Well, the TCP handshake and the thing HTTP 1.1 is used, it's creating latency, and we could, the bandwidth could optimize it for a while, but then it's the latency that's the bottleneck.
Yeah, and to get around this, we have HTTP2 when it was developed on Google called Speedy in the beginning.
Yeah.
And later on, the Internet Engineering Task Force took this like Speedy protocol and they started to take care of it as a standard. So it's an RFC 7540 right now, and it became an RFC back in the last year.
Mm.
And as we said before, it's supported in all modern browsers.
Yeah.
The big sites are using this, and it's basically another model of handling, especially multiplexing.
Yeah, that's the main thing, I think, because now it's HTTP is taking care of TCP in a good way. So you have one single TCP connection, and you can send the data through that connection as you will think in a socket way.
Yeah.
More.
And we have this thing which server pushes, so the server could like find out that, okay, we are getting a response for an index or a request for an index.html, and we see that, okay, we will get requests for CSS files and JavaScript files, and we could prepare the client.
The server can act more intelligent using this new protocol.
Preparing and making it faster, compressing HTTP headers. We don't need to send all the headers all
the
time.
As you see, the headers in the plain text is sending every request, every response. It's going to be some data sending back and forth.
Yeah, and you have a link here to Grigoric's talk about HTTP2, so
I
it's
think
a good thing to
watch. Yeah, it's a good talk to look at.
Yeah, and so back to why is it important for web developers? Well, first of all, in HTTP2, or the main reason in HTTP2, it's not, we don't have this problem with manual requests anymore. So it's, I mean, in HTTP1, it's a problem to send a lot of requests. So we need to package all our, for instance, JavaScript files or CSS files into one big file, serving it to the client.
So we just have to do
one request,
because we have to open a connection and all the stuff.
Yeah, but in HTTP2, it's not bad to have a lot of files. It could even be a good thing, I guess, because you could do like caching. Or
yeah, because if you have five files and you only change in one of them, in the old way you build them together and you have to recache the big file.
Yep.
In this case you only have to recache one little file.
Yep.
So the other four files are already
cached and remain the same. So and that's why I said that, okay, so maybe it's not always a good thing to do this browserify way where we pack everything together. It could actually be quite nice to have a lot of files even on the client, but this is why.
Yeah,
basically.
But remember, all the thing with methods, responses, and headers, they are, for us as a developer, they are all the same.
Yeah,
so we don't have to. Yeah, so we don't have to think about it. It's just a smarter protocol that take better use of the TCP connection.
So while John is looking into the question, this is pretty much this for this.
Yeah,
question.
We have some questions. Can we talk a bit more on the login thingy? Well, what we can say, the thing there is to, okay, we have a login form and you're gonna create a web scraper. So you will have the username and password, your script is sending that to the server, probably it went well and the login succeeded, and probably the server will send you back a cookie. So the next request you get, you maybe get a redirect, I don't know. Check the thing from the server, how it responds when you do the login, and you have to keep the server state, so yeah.
Sending the cookie, yeah, with every request.
If you want more, we could take it on the tutoring.
Yeah, on the tutoring, yeah. Tomorrow. So we have this tutoring session tomorrow. Is it tomorrow? No, Wednesday.
Yeah.
Wednesday. So if you have any questions, we could answer them on the tutoring sessions. So.
Yeah. Will we be in Requeer next lecture, they were wondering?
No. Probably not, because we have a really busy schedule this week, this period, this semester, because we have multiple courses, and getting to a lecture is an overhead of 5 hours for 2 hours of lecture, and we so know,
no,
basically. And I hope this format works. Of course, this is the first test with this like format of lecturing.
Yeah.
So please tell us on Slack, how does it work? Is it, what could we make better? We know that the mic is quite sensitive right now. We will probably need to fix that.
It takes longer time, I think.
Yeah, so this is actually took probably half an hour.
We promised to show some code, but I think I record a demo about
the
that.
AliExpress,
yeah, because I want, so I do a little demo and put it on the course webpage.
Yeah.
Just going through the code we were supposed to go through in this session.
Yeah. So, hope it worked. Please let us know and see you on Wednesday for those of you who want to learn.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.